asking the questions mainstream journalists will never ask. This is your Richie Allen Show on richieallen.co.uk, Fab Radio 2 in Manchester, and triggerwarning.tv.
Let's welcome our next guest back to the programme. This is a very big story, this. The data watchdog is not or is investigating the Metropolitan Police's gangs database following accusations that it isn't fit for purpose. Now, a report by Amnesty International found the force's gang violence matrix was racially discriminatory and breaches human rights law. This database was set up after the 2011 London riots. You might remember those. And on the database, well, there are about 3,500, maybe 4,000 persons of interest. The Metropolitan Police said that the matrix helped prevent young lives being lost. And the BBC wrote today on bbc.co.uk, the report by Amnesty found the matrix tracked a disproportionate number of minorities, as well as 1,500 people who police had assessed as posing no danger of committing violence. Let's welcome back to the show our next guest. I think he's a great guy. He's a whistleblower. I came across him last year when he told a number of newspapers and television news channels that the government was telling lies about policing numbers on the streets of the UK. Absolutely devastating interviews he gave. He is a former police officer, but in fact a very senior police officer, senior investigating officer for many years. Let's welcome back to the programme Peter Kirkham. Peter, thanks for coming back. How are you?
I'm all right, Richie. How are you?
I'm very well, mate. Thanks for doing it. I know you've been busy today. I caught you on the Victoria Derbyshire programme earlier on. I know you've been doing the rounds. I thought you did well on that programme, to be honest. So, Amnesty says the list, let's call it the list, the database, is racially discriminatory and therefore breaches human rights law. But you disagree.
I do. It's the same sort of argument as with stop and search and the disproportionality arguments there. They're using the sort of population data as the baseline for their comparators. And therefore, they're creating a disproportionality that's not actually the case. In the case of the gangs database, the gang label's pretty difficult and not particularly helpful. The database is around street crime groups, those involved in street crime in a sort of semi-organised way. Groupings, like I say, for the want of a better label, they've been called gangs. But groups that get involved in street drug dealing and other street crime at more than antisocial behaviour, more than individual criminality or just a couple of guys getting up to no good, but nowhere near the level of organised crime, your armed robbers, your drug importers, and that sort of level of stuff. So they're sort of middle level or middling level. Now, those, you need to look at who's involved in that crime and then ask who's on the database and see if there's comparison between those two sets of demographics, not the census population demographic. And when you look at who's involved in street crime in any city, it is predominantly young, mid-teens to mid-20s. It's predominantly young males who live in the inner city areas. Well, in London, certainly the inner London areas where there is a particular street crime problem, the population is very much, the young male population is very much more black and minority ethnic than it is elsewhere in London or in the overall census population. If you look at other cities, Manchester and Liverpool, very much more white, West Midlands, Birmingham, very much more Asian. So it reflects the demographics of the city in which the street crime is happening. Therefore, in London, it just so happens at the moment, that's what the demographic is. So if you've got a database that's meant to be working on those that are involved in this, potentially involved in this, or potentially the victims of this particular type of crime, then they're going to reflect the demographics of those in it, which, as I've just said, reflects the demographics of the inner city youth. And so it would be odd if it wasn't predominantly black.
Why do you think Amnesty... I mean, Amnesty would have access to those figures. And I've been listening to you today and I've had a look and I can confirm I certainly don't have your skills, Peter, at analysing data. But from what I can do, it seems that you're right. So this is not helpful at all. And it's a particularly sensitive time for police officers in this country in the wake of claims made about grooming gangs and how those grooming gangs weren't fully investigated because police forces feared that they would be accused of what Amnesty is basically accusing them of today. So why is this happening if it's fit? I'm not going to use the pun black and white, but if it's obvious, why then are Amnesty and other groups playing the race card?
You have to ask Amnesty that. I think they've got an axe to grind. Some of these organisations are naturally anti-police, or certainly there's a degree of antipathy towards the police. Some of them don't like the concept of policing. A lot of them are naive, and I think Amnesty are a little bit naive in what they're looking at here. I don't know if you saw in their report, but there was one line where they were criticising the police and the Matrix database because these people that were suspected of being involved in these serious crimes and at the, you know, at the top end of the scale, even though it's middling level criminality, we're talking about people that are carrying and using knives and murdering people. So, you know, serious stuff. They were drawing attention to the fact they thought it was a breach of the Data Protection Act because the suspects hadn't been told they were on the database. And you just go, what? How can anybody think that the police would have a duty to tell a suspect they're working on, they've heard is involved in serious crime, they've got grounds to believe is involved in serious crime and they're working on, that you would have to tell them that you're working on them? It's just insanity. And it's people that do not understand what they're criticising. There's some things in that report. They're valid points. I certainly wouldn't argue that the database is perfect. Lots of police officers don't argue that it's perfect in terms of delivering what they need in terms of being able to develop their prosecution packages or their investigative packages or to identify the risk and protect potential victims. And you mentioned grooming gangs earlier on. We've heard recently about the grooming of young people, vulnerable young people, to become couriers and whatever in the so-called county lines type drug dealing, which is developing from the street drug dealing. And it's been, the police have been told this is a safeguarding issue. Well, this database actually identifies those around the main players who aren't necessarily main players or much involved at all yet themselves, certainly not convicted yet. And the idea is to identify if they're getting in too deep, then interventions can be made to get them back out again. So there's no coherence to this criticism at all. It's just an incoherent rant against the police, basically. And it doesn't even stand up on its own facts.
Peter Kirkham is our guest. This is really, really interesting stuff and it's really important. Peter, what sort of stuff would be, what sort of information about an individual would be on the database? Are we talking their movements? Are we talking their associations? What sort of stuff?
It could be. The Matrix itself is sort of like an index almost to standard intelligence database. And that applies to all types of crime, not just this type of crime. Obviously, the police have got intelligence on all sorts of people involved in all sorts of things. But typically, you know, starting at the top, it would include links to all their convictions, which are obviously held on the police national computer anyway. And then coming down from there, it would include all times that they were arrested but not charged or charged but not convicted. It would include all mentions of any non-court type disposals of cases. It would deal, once they're on the database, it would be updated with things like if they were stop and searched, if they were seen in a particular vehicle and stopped in a particular vehicle, if there was surveillance being carried out somewhere, maybe on another suspect or subject, that they were identified as being associated with them. It could be any number of things once they're on the database as somebody that appears to be connected with this type of crime in some way, you're then gathering everything you can to try and make sense of, are they an up-and-coming main player? Are they a bit part player? Are they nothing really to do with it, just happen to hang around with some of the players? Or are they someone that's the main players are trying to inveigle into getting involved? And so it's gathering whatever you've got. Now, it's reviewed every reviewed every month, I think, at borough level. It's certainly reviewed regularly. And over the period of time, I think there's 3,000 or nearly 4,000 people on it at the moment, but 3,000 or 4,000 people have been on it and come off it again.
And have come off periods. It. Oh, that's interesting now. Sorry to interrupt you, Peter. That's interesting because I was going to ask you, is there any judicial input to the likes of this matrix? Would there be any judicial oversight at all?
Not really, not directly.
Right.
Because you've got... It's a police intelligence database. What there is the Data Protection Act, because intelligence is plainly personal information. And so the police intelligence systems are subject to the rules of the Data Protection Act. And obviously the Information Commissioner is the one that checks out how it's operating. Now, there are some exceptions in the Data Protection Act, Section 29, Subsection 3. In particular, but other bits of sections 29 and associated sections around that provide exclusions for the handling and processing and sharing of data, personal data, where it's for the purposes of the investigation, prosecution of crime. And so obviously this will fall within those exceptions. And so the police will be able to keep data and they will be able to share data with partner organisations. That was another thing that Amnesty was criticising, the police were sharing data with other agencies.
What about deleting it, Peter? Sorry to interrupt you again, and thanks for coming back on, by the way. I know you're busy. I'm sure there are other people trying to get you there, but we've got you for the time being. We're keeping you for another 10 minutes because this is very important stuff. I wanted to interject there because what about data deletion? Now, I don't mind being on a database like that, even if it's accidental. And by the way, my listeners will kill me because I'm not saying that if you're not doing anything wrong, you shouldn't worry about it. I'm not saying that at all. I don't like a surveillance state. I don't want to live in a Big Brother society. However, if I accidentally end up on one of these databases, I'm an easygoing guy. I'll say, look, fair enough. And if the police gets in touch with me to say I was on a database, fair enough. What about deletion? People, before we move on to talk about more serious things, people are surely entitled to get assurances that if it's been deemed that they really shouldn't be on there, that anything relating to them, pertaining to them, will be deleted, right?
Yes, it will be deleted. Like I said, the Data Protection Act has deletion requirements. And so as soon as police intelligence is no longer required for an operational policing purpose linked to those exceptions about investigating and prosecuting crime, then it will be constantly reviewed and will be deleted. Otherwise, the intelligence databases just get clogged up with all sorts of ancient and irrelevant stuff. It has to be kept up to date as well. So if somebody disappears off the matrix for some reason or disappears off the radar for some reason, say they go abroad or whatever, then it may well be that will be deleted anyway. It's always been a bit of an issue with the police service. I've dealt with armed robbers myself for a long time. And at the time when the Data Protection Act sort of came in with particular teeth in the late 90s, and we had a real sort of soul searching about our intelligence databases and how they were going to be compliant, because we obviously needed to know about the armed robbers and their associates and what they did and everything else for when they came out, because we know armed robbers go in, come out and do it again, but they go in for quite a long time. So it might be 10 or 12 years later when your only update is, well, he's still in Brixton.
Right.
And, you know, and so there are protocols in place and consideration can be given to keeping it as long as it can be justified. And the regulator would be the Information Commissioner if there were any issues around that. Unfortunately, the public aren't going to find out a lot about this for the exactly the same reason I said earlier on. The police are not going to be sharing intelligence, criminal intelligence information with the public, for the simple reason that rather undermines the system and the point of the whole thing.
Fair enough. I just want to acknowledge that I am getting tweets and I'm not surprised. There are people who will just never trust any form of authority with their data, and you know, logistics information about them. They'll never trust it. I've had tweets from people saying that they don't believe that the data doesn't get misused. I just want to acknowledge those, because if I don't, I'll be hammered for it later on. I'm not taking a side here at all. I like Peter a lot because of his honesty and because of what he's done. He's proven himself, you know, but I understand why people say that. Say, oh, I just don't trust any authority to hold my data without misusing. I just want to acknowledge a lot of people are saying that. Peter, well,
I don't blame people.
You don't blame people
that,
for saying
and,
that.
And I certainly don't subscribe to, if you've done nothing wrong, you've got nothing to fear, yeah, argument. I don't subscribe to that at all, because people can get on there for innocent reasons. Yeah. I don't think you get on there by accident, but you know, you could just be someone who's a mate of someone that, unbeknown to you, is involved in all sorts of skullduggery. And so, you know, you get sort of sucked into it that way. So, you know, the safeguards are there. And it's the point that Amnesty were making today was, we've got some concerns, we've pushed them to the Information Commissioner, who's going to have a look at them. Well, that's how the system should work. What I'm not quite sure why Amnesty did was they put out all their allegations as if they were proven fact today, when they're not. They're allegations that have been passed to the Information Commissioner, who will look at them and who will make some sort of judgment on whether the police are dealing with the data properly.
Everybody is terrified these days, no matter what industry you're working in, of being deemed to be insensitive to other cultures or to ethnic minorities. And we mentioned Rotherham and Rochdale, and Maggie Oliver's been on this programme. We've talked about that, and alleged police failings because the police's hands were tied because they were worried about being accused of, you know, endemic racism if they were going after the Asian grooming gangs. Is what Amnesty said today, before we briefly talk about the problems in London, is what Amnesty did today, is this going to harm policing effectively in the foreseeable future? Are officers looking at this going to be scared? Yeah,
it is. It's another thing that will undermine their confidence, willingness and morale to get on with the job. They know that they're not using this in a racist way. They understand that it may have some imperfections. They understand that the knife crime angle especially is affecting the black community. But they know that they are out there every day doing everything they can to try and save these kids from being slaughtered. And they are probably the only agency that is doing that 24/7. Well, they are the only agency that's doing it 24/7. They are the first on scene at the stabbings and shootings. They're the ones that have got their hands in the wounds and on the wounds, trying to stop the kids bleeding to death before the ambulance service turn up. And with the cuts to the ambulance service, that may be 20 or 30 minutes routinely. And I've heard of a case where it was nearly an hour. So you've got police officers that are dealing with horrific stabbing and shooting injuries. They are desperately trying to save the lives of these young black kids that have been shot and stabbed. And they're being called racists and being told they don't care. And now they're being told by Amnesty that their database that's trying to identify the bad guys and get them locked up, and B, identify the victims and get them protected if possible, that's being used in a racist way. So, yeah, of course it's demoralising them and undermining them at a time when morale couldn't be any bloody lower, to be honest.
And on that, because a lot of people in this country were alerted by you, and I know you're a very you're a very straight down the line type of guy. You certainly didn't do it for any personal gain, certainly not for fame.
It's costing me money, mate.
It's costing you money. And we talked about that last time you're on, and we can talk about that again. A lot of people, me included, are aware of how devastating cuts have been to the police in this country and what that has resulted in. Now, Trump is in the news today, he was in the news yesterday, the day before. You've leaders of other countries saying that it's like the OK Corral in London. We're hearing that murder rates in London are greater than New York City. Who'd have ever believed all of that? Mm-hmm. Is that directly related? Is that a result of the cuts to the police that we've seen in successive years and in successive governments? Is that why it seems to be getting worse? Because every time I go online, whether it's the Mail, whether it's the Telegraph, whether it's the Daily Mirror, whether it's the bloody Guardian, somebody's been chopped up with a machete or stabbed or shot It is scary, Peter. I'm not an old man. I'm a 43-year-old guy. I'm a pretty relaxed type of guy. But when I read that sort of stuff, it does kind of scare me. And I live in Manchester City, pretty much city centre. And you think, Jesus, what's going on? Is that what's going on? The police has been devastated to the point that all hell is breaking loose now.
It is. And there is, in my view, there's definitely a link. It's not the only link. It's certainly not the cause of why people carry knives. But if the things that cause people to carry knives aren't being addressed, and I'd point to other cuts there, cuts to youth services, cuts to funding for community groups and diversionary activities like youth sports groups and whatever, cuts to child and adolescent mental health, cuts to support for children, especially leaving care, cuts to support for families that are struggling, where the family's not particularly functional and the children are going astray, cuts to support, educational support for those excluded from mainstream schools. All of those factors and more feed into why people are getting involved in street crime. And once they're involved in street crime, then the violence that goes with that and the inter-gang rivalry and the squabbles about turf and whatever come from that. So all of those things are the causes, or feed into the causes. But if someone's carrying a knife, the only agency left that's going to keep any sort of lid on it is going to be the police service. And that is why when the police service have been cut so they're not patrolling, they're able to patrol the streets anymore in a proactive sort of way, and they're undermined about using stop and search and whatever anyway. There's no point in being there unless they're doing something. But that is why the lid has come off and the cat is out of the bag. I use the hashtag on Twitter, Whose Streets? And we are getting not just more serious offences, but we're getting more blatant serious offences. We've seen the moped crime gangs. They're not just doing the smash and grabs at the expensive handbag shops in Sloane Street and Bond Street of a night time now. They're doing it in broad daylight, in front of crowds, in front of CCTV. They don't care because they know that it's highly unlikely the cops will turn up in sufficient numbers to catch them whilst they're still doing it. And if they do, they just zoom off on their mopeds, and it's highly unlikely, and they'd have to be damned unlucky to find that it's an authorised unit with a boss in the control room that authorises a pursuit and a hard stop. So they know they can get away with it, and they're getting more and more blatant. You see it with the knife crime stabbings as well. They chase their victims down at 4 o'clock in the afternoon in a street full of commuters and stab them to death, butcher them in front of a street full of commuters and the CCTV. They're getting more blatant because the streets have been lost. The powers of law and order have been withdrawn from the streets because of the cuts, and the streets have been lost to the bad guys. And it's as bad in Manchester city centre. It may even be worse in parts of Manchester in terms of the cuts to policing than it is in the Met, but it's in the centre of all towns and cities. It's reduced significantly.
We've not seen that sort of violence here, thank God, that has erupted in London. And
no, you've not got it on the same scale.
No.
And obviously, you know, all cities, even the Birmingham and Manchester's, they're on a totally different scale to London. And that's, I think, why you don't notice it. But there are stabbings there, and there are... in fact, I think the rate per 100,000 of knife murders is slightly higher in Manchester and Liverpool and Birmingham and Glasgow than it is in London. But that again is probably a little bit misleading, because London's got a lot of suburbs where there's very little. So it's sort of focused in the middle.
I know you don't agree with this, but I'm going to say it anyway. We had this last time you were on, and I believe services, not just policing, but historically, not just in the UK, other countries I've lived in, services are run down in order for privatisation to be introduced. And I believe too often we, in the media, not me anymore now that I've moved away from mainstream press, but too often journalists and commentators give a pass to politicians and blame it on incompetence. I don't think it's incompetence. I believe it's a pretty measured plan to basically privatise policing in this country. And to me, it's as plain as the nose of my face. What do you think, Peter?
I think I'm aware of the concept, and it's been well written about. I mean, if anyone's not familiar with it, maybe they might like to read Naomi Klein's book, Shock Doctrine, about it. And it gives examples around the world of how basically some sort of shock, be it a natural disaster or an epidemic of something or austerity or something like that, is used to just throw everything up in the air and make changes that governments want to make, especially capitalist governments want to make, that they wouldn't otherwise get through. And so, you know, I understand that logic. And certainly when Theresa May started with undermining the police service, I thought with lots of others that that may be where she was going. It may well have been where she was going, but if she wanted to privatise the police service in any significant way, she was going to be relying on the companies like G4S and Serco, who would be the only ones that would be able to take that on. And they've taken similar things on in other countries. But they then sort of shot themselves totally in the foot by proving themselves incompetent and dishonest in the contracts that they had. So she might have had that idea and then decided to ditch it when suddenly she hadn't got anybody to privatise it to. Personally,
there'll always be others, though, Peter.
I'm not convinced she was. I think she's just doesn't like the police and is just destroying them out of spite. I don't think there's a master plan, because if you look at manifestos and don't forget, you know, since the coalition started in 2010, we've had manifestos in 2010, 2015, 2017. There's no mention of privatisation. There's no traces of consultations and green papers and white papers. It would need huge amounts of enabling legislation, primary legislation. There's no indication of that being pushed through. So if that was her plan, it certainly it doesn't appear to be what's happening now.
What about these companies like Serco and G4S? I would imagine a distinguished man like yourself, and I'm not kissing your backside, Peter. I don't know you at all, apart from speaking to you in January, but you are distinguished. I've spoken to other policemen and women on programmes over the years that served with distinction as well. You must have a very dim view of these companies, Serco and G4S and others. Because ultimately that's what they want. I mean, you talked about the contracts that they, you know, might have messed up through their behaviour, through their handling of those contracts, their own staff problems, all that sort of stuff. But ultimately these companies do, I would say, have ambitions. And I would say they play the long game and stealth in getting more and more involved in public life. What do you think of these companies? I would imagine you're not serving anymore, former police officer like yourself, would take a dim view of them.
I do. I think they're parasitic on society. All of this privatisation, we've seen it in the health service, we've seen it with the probation service, we've seen it with the PFIs, we've seen it with all sorts of council services. When you actually look at it and privatise a good source of information about these shenanigans, when you look at it, there's lots of ducking and diving done to make it sound like they're going to save money. And then 3, 4, 5, 6 years later, it all comes back in house or it all falls apart because they pile it high, they sell it cheap, they try and cut costs everywhere, and quality just goes straight out the window, and then you get failure. In a policing context, we've had it with forensic science services. Theresa May decided the National Forensic Science Service, which was an arm's length government organisation, which was a recognised international worldwide centre of excellence for forensic science. She binned it, one of the first things she did. And that left police forces either doing their own in-house forensics. Well, it's not their day job, so quality and all the rest of it starts to fall by the wayside. And it went to privatised companies. And I think it was up in your part of the world. Was it Randox or something like that that fell apart? Because they were cutting corners, not doing the quality assurance, and loads of drink drive and drug drive cases had to be reviewed because of cutting corners. So privatisation, no, it could have a place in some parts of policing, not just the administrative support, but on a small scale, you could do all sorts of things, but you'd need a specialist company that understood policing and weren't piling them high and selling them cheap. And neither the police service nor the procurement rules that the police service has to operate by allow small specialist companies that know what they're doing to get involved in this. It all becomes mega scaled up and it becomes only the likes of G4S and Serco and co
in
that
a way,
are in a position to do that, and they are rapacious corporate raiders, basically.
Parasites was a great word used to describe them. You kind of, just a little bit, kind of made some of my argument for me there. I'm not being disingenuous when I say that. I'm going to finish with this. Thanks for coming on again, mate. You've had a long day, and I appreciate you coming on with us tonight. Thanks for doing
no
it.
No problem.
This my local Bobby. Now, we had a brief chat today, and you said to me that you don't see that being sustainable. Yet the Metro, but we must tell the audience first of all, this is the private police force which the Metro newspaper says is expanding nationally because it's had a bit of success in three wealthy London areas. Now, I think that's where Peter was coming from today. He'll talk to us about that in a second. These are bobbies who charge somewhere between £100 and £200 a month. They're not bobbies, but they are basically a private police force. They let people who pay for them track their progress using an iPad app. It was set up by two former Met police officers. They're not PCs. They can make citizens' arrests and they can gather evidence for private prosecutions. Now, you said you don't see the future in this. Some of the papers today saying that this my local Bobby is expanding nationally. Now, I would say to you, my friend, stealth. Who's to say in 2 or 3 or 4 years' time this hasn't grown and grown and the next Prime Minister or the next Home Secretary says, you know what, we should be doing business with these guys. Go ahead.
Again, you can't just convert someone who's basically a security guard, that's what they are, and so they've got no police powers whatsoever.
Yeah.
You can't convert them into police officers without primary legislation. The Office of Constable is where the powers of constables come from. If we hear Theresa May talking about attacking the Office of Constable, we really do need to worry. I haven't heard her talk about it. She sort of mentioned a few things that I'm thinking maybe it's bouncing around in her mind. But I've got to say that I don't think Theresa May's got long enough to do anything much left, to be honest.
No, and she might not, but it's a long game, isn't it?
As for the company, I simply don't think its business model will work. My day job that I should be doing instead of talking to you for nothing about this is security management consultancy. I've done that for large companies. I haven't done it in-house. Colleagues of mine do it as an in-house member of staff for large companies. I've done it as a contractor, an outsourced provider for large companies. But there's a big gap in the market for small companies, the vast, vast majority of small and medium-sized companies in an area, and also residential properties, to understand crime prevention. And then if they're a victim of crime, maybe get some additional support and some self-help. So there's scope for that there, and I'm looking at that. I wouldn't go anywhere near the patrol thing, because when I've looked at what people are willing to pay, it ain't anywhere near £200 a month. Nowhere near. Maybe £200 a year. You're not going to get £200 a year enough to put you patrols on. And I think they will rapidly see they're not getting very much for their money anyway.
I hope you're right.
I don't see it succeeding.
I hope you're right. And I genuinely hope that in 3 or 4 years' time, you and I are not talking about the introduction of primary legislation to make that nightmare a reality. Peter, thanks for giving us your time, mate. I really appreciate that. And thanks for speaking out on these issues.
No problem.
Look after yourself. Bye for now. Yeah. That's Peter Kirkham, live on the line there. Peter's a very senior retired Metropolitan Police investigating officer and blew the whistle spectacularly last year on the lies of successive Conservative and previously, of course, Conservative Lib Dem coalition governments for lying, falsifying data, manipulating numbers, making it look like they were putting more police officers on the street when in fact they weren't. He was talking there about the Amnesty International claim that the Metropolitan Police and its database, its gang matrix database, is effectively racist and racially discriminatory and breaches human rights law. Peter said there categorically that isn't true, that it obviously isn't true, and he explained why it isn't. I looked at his reasoning today and I think he's absolutely right. Nobody is saying that young black men are more likely to be knife-wielding savages than anybody else. Nobody's saying that at all. But young black men are more likely, particularly in inner city London, to be in very dire financial circumstances, socially deprived. That's a fact. And if you look at it yourself without me going on and on and on about it, you'll see that Amnesty's claim that the database is racist is pretty much, shall we say it for the first time, monumental bollocks. It isn't racially motivated, at least not as far as I can see anyway. As far as privatising the police goes, I believe that what we're seeing in London is part of problem, reaction, solution. I think Peter Kirkham is eminently honest, completely honest, and he doesn't see it going down the road that I see it going down. But that's okay, we can agree to disagree. But I believe passionately, and I've been saying this for years, that policing and the National Health Service, more than anything, are being systematically, fundamentally destroyed to create the outrage and the reaction. And you can only imagine in certain parts of London what people are thinking with these stories. And I don't want to be one of these, you know, won't somebody please think of the children? You know, I'm not saying that it's like Beirut in London. But this type of violence is on the increase. And as he said there, there are a number of reasons for it. Obviously, youth development programs, youth hostels, investment in things for young people to do, particularly young people in areas where there isn't much going on. That has disappeared completely. And at the same time, numbers of police officers are disappearing off the streets. He said the streets are lost. I say it's deliberate. It's problem, reaction, solution. And we will see that primary legislation within the next few years where they say, you know, we didn't want it to come to this, but, you know, we're going to introduce this company. It's a company that we came across. It's in America. It's got a great track record of working with local law enforcement authorities to deliver policing in areas where there are serious problems. Before you know it, you've got private, a corporation providing some, not all, but some of the policing in your local neighbourhood. And you know what will go hand in hand with that, dear listener? You got it in one. The privatisation of the prisons, which is already happening in this country. It's not nearly as advanced here as it is in the United States. See Correction Corporations of America as one example. But it's coming in here as well. Why? Well, it's lockdown. It's Agenda 20, Agenda 30, future one world government, Orwellian police state nightmare. It has to have full lockdown. The people have to be absolutely under a boot. Which we're not there yet, not quite anyway. But that's what it is. That's what's coming down the line. You have a situation in America where the vast majority of prisons across the vast landscape that is North America are run by private corporations. You have a situation in America where these corporations did deals with the state legislatures whereby they were guaranteed that if they took over the prisons, the state would guarantee them 95% occupancy at all times. Think about that. Think about the evil of that. Hi, we're the Corrections Corporations of America. We'll take over your prisons so long as you guarantee they're always feckin' full. No problems, no problems. We'll sign on the dotted line there. That's what's coming here, you see. Fear-mongering, Richie. I'm not fear-mongering. I've never fear-mongered on any programme I've ever presented. I'm telling you the truth. This is what's coming. Private police force, private prisons, NHS no longer free at the point of entry.